Welcome, everybody. I'd like to call, oh, where did that? Any changes, comments on the agenda?
Nope.
Okay, let's move on to board matters.
Wait, sorry. Can you report out of closed session real quick?
Oh.
We locked the door.
We came out of closed session. We went in at 6:30, ended at 7:30. No action was taken.
Sorry, I'm late.
Thank you for coming. All right, so we are in E, board matters. One, item one, resignation of Justin Kai from Board of Directors effective September 14th. Do I have a motion to accept that?
I move to accept.
Second? Okay. Any discussion?
No.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, item two, discuss appointment process and timing to fill upcoming Board of Directors position vacancy. Eric, he gave us papers.
Well, I sent all of you information on what is Government Code 1780.
Mm-hmm.
That is going to basically dictate your timing on this. You have up to 60 days to make the appointment, which would put you around sometime just barely after your scheduled November meeting. With that said, it doesn't mean that you need to take that long to make the appointment. However, you cannot make an appointment until at least 15 days has passed after a notice has been published, notice of vacancy and any request for appointment applications. That's that in a nutshell. Keep in mind, the meeting you make the appointment, the director will not sit that meeting, because once the appointment is made, I have to get information to the county, at which point they will process it, create his oath, send that back to me. The director has to take the oath, sign the oath, at which point they become a sitting board member. However, as long as the appointment is made within 60 days, they don't have to be seated within 60 days.
Notice of vacancy is something that you prepare and publish in three different conspicuous places, is that right?
Yes. Okay. It needs to, it's all, I have it here, and without reading it, just going off the top of my mind, it does need to be posted in three conspicuous places. My initial thoughts were obviously we would put it on the bulletin board out front. It would also be, I believe they have a bulletin board at Marinwood Market that they would allow us to do. And then my third thought was honestly to probably tape one to a pole in Creekside Park.
Why can't we do the website?
Well, this is physical paper posting.
Oh, it has to be physical?
Yes.
All right,
yes.
So.
And the answer to why can't you do the website or things like that is because the rationale is not everybody has access to or accesses the internet. Same reason.
So that cannot serve even as one of the three?
I do not believe so.
Correct.
No.
Okay.
The district shall post a notice of the vacancy in three or more conspicuous places in the district at least 15 days prior to the board makes the appointment. The district shall notify the county elections official of the appointment no more than blah, blah, blah. But with that said, it will also be on the website. I will send, most likely I would recommend posting it in the legal notice section of the IJ, which will incur a cost. I don't know if the IJ would want to give us some column filler for free, but I doubt it. To post a legal notice costs money, so I'll have to look into that process. I don't have exact numbers in front of me. It's not astronomical, it's a nominal fee. But I would recommend putting it in there. The information I need personally for this is the board to kind of designate a due date, as well as what they would like to see in terms of the request for applications.
Excuse me, when will you be taking questions?
After.
I have a question.
I would probably say when they call that portion of this agenda topic.
Because you're talking about, you're not talking about what the bylaws say. You're talking about something different.
We're talking about a discussion item on here, so I think first the board will discuss and then we'll...
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
We're talking about, it's just a discussion item at this point, and then we'll open it up to the public in just a minute. But Eric, this is
okay.
The first time we're hearing this, so don't worry. So in terms of the timeline, I mean, it seems as though you actually just said a whole bunch of things that I would have said I would have wanted you to do, you know, in terms of listing in places and getting it out there. I mean, I think probably I think as quickly as possible that we
right.
can...
Okay, let me rephrase. for the posting itself, I would like to put an application deadline on it.
Oh.
So when would you like, you know, I think decisions that need, you know, direction I need tonight is an application deadline.
When are you going to be posting it?
Ideally this week.
And I think we will have to be interviewing the candidates at the October meeting. Mm. So all their application letters should be in the packet, obviously. So then we should give each other, ourselves, enough time to get all the information in. So I'd say a week before
the next board meeting.
The next board meeting would be.
So that's before. October 4th.
Fourth.
So we're going to give people about three weeks to respond.
I'm sorry, I missed that part.
So October 4th gives us 1 week before the next board meeting.
Okay.
So either that day or sometime that week. So as is supposed to say.
About the 7th, so yeah, probably by the 5th or 6th at the latest.
At the very latest. Sure. I guess my question would be why you'd want to turn it around quite that quickly unless your intention is to make an appointment at the October meeting.
Interviews.
Yeah.
We need to interview the people and... We could have an appointment meeting.
But I mean, if we have the people and we can know what we want to do, we might as well do it sooner rather than
later. Okay, that's fine. I would have to inform you that if you want to go through interview process, that needs to be public, happen in an open session. So you'd be calling a separate meeting for it.
That's what they've done in the past. The board had a special meeting for interview process, and it was an open meeting where the candidates were interviewed.
Why can't that be at the regular meeting?
It can be at the regular meeting, but...
It has been in the past. It's not unprecedented.
It's been at regular meetings and special meetings, mm-hmm. Yes.
Right. So I'm just trying to make sure I am fully understanding kind of what the current suggestion is, which would be applications come in a due date with enough time to publish all applications prior to, with the October board packet.
Mm-hmm.
Then the intention would be to have candidate statements or candidate interviews, not candidate, applicant statements or interviews at the October meeting.
Mm-hmm. And this, it should be a statement and a resume maybe, or just a statement? Any preferences?
I mean, I see the pros and cons of dividing it out of the October meeting and having a special meeting, because depending on how many people there are, if it was a special meeting, it just doesn't draw other people usually as much, and our meetings vary with how many people in the public there are, but you kind of just can focus just on that one thing. If I think Eric had indicated the October meeting might be busy, my only concern was that if it's in the middle of a regularly scheduled meeting, that it would sort of be, you know, one and done, just kind of rushing through it. So, mm-hmm. Again, very minor minutia. In terms of if we want to target the board meeting, I don't care either way, but if we were going to target having them here, then, I mean, but I think to me, my general idea is that the sooner the better with all of it, just to get a full board, and I think it also looks good to the community that, you know, we had a resignation, and then as quickly as possible, we're moving to fill it. If on the crazy chance, you know, nobody applied or something like that, that would give us more time to dig for people, because sometimes it's hard to get volunteers.
One way to have it at the board meeting, we'd have more people here.
That's true.
So, curiosity question. Are we targeting having someone sitting, a fifth member sitting at this table by the November meeting, the December meeting? When?
Doesn't the state say 60 days, right? We have to make a decision.
You have to make an appointment within 60 days.
And it has to be advertised for 15 days.
Right.
So if we post it, let's say tomorrow, I think a month for submitting an application is plenty of time.
And we'd have to pick somebody before the November meeting, I think.
We have to pick somebody on
or by the November meeting.
Yeah,
my
thought you said we had a week after, because it's already... It's 60 days starts from when? To
14.
The effective date, the 14th. Yeah, so that's after that's after the October meeting. Or sorry, the November meeting.
I would suggest that we're possibly going to end up seating somebody by the December meeting, not the November meeting, based on the timeline. But, you know, to give ample time for advertising the position, collecting any responses that we get, conducting interviews, and you know, then making a decision? Are we going to be conducting interviews and making a decision at the same meeting?
I think that's the last question we have to answer.
That's up to you. I mean, that's kind of what I'm asking.
If we were going to make a collective decision without doing the interviews in a normal meeting, we would have to create another public meeting to make that, to discuss and make that decision, correct?
Correct.
Okay. I think both in the same meeting would be good.
I would tend to agree with you. And like I said, I to Leah's point, can see the pros in moving quickly to fill the position. I think I can also see the pros in extending the application period time to allow greater notification, more people to make sure that they are aware, more people to turn it in. And I will also say, just as an FYI, the October meeting would be Tuesday, October 11th, which is the eve of Yom Kippur, which is a major Jewish holiday that could potentially prevent people from attending that meeting.
That's a good point.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Maybe I'll observe this year, and then I won't have to.
just putting that out there. I personally appreciate the notion of trying to get somebody in as efficiently as possible, but I also don't think that making the appointment in the November meeting personally is dragging the process on either.
No, I agree, and it sounds as though having a little more time might be the more expedient way to do it, so I would just, you know.
Okay, fine. I really don't...
I don't have a strong opinion, so...
Neither do I.
Yeah.
If we're aiming to appoint in November, let's start the process of notification and see what starts coming in.
Mm-hmm. So then the call for responses, the due date for applications will be a week before the November board meeting? And we would be hearing from the candidates or seeing their statement of interest in the November meeting, and then in the November meeting also making an appointment.
And I also have to say, the November meeting is election day, just in case anyone's going to be sitting at home.
That's true.
So I'm looking at my calendar.
Mm-hmm. November 9th?
November 8th.
November 8th?
Yeah. I think so.
So then we would make a decision in the
November
meeting.
Fitting. Somebody will get a spot on
We could have a little election party here.
And then and you will do whatever you need to do after the November meeting. So then we would have a new board member for the December meeting.
Yeah, that sounds applicable. And then I would also say, in terms of creating the posting, I mean, I'm happy to put that together. Let's just take a worst case scenario that it is done and ready to be out by this Friday, the 16th. I'll obviously try to do it sooner than that. I'm just looking at creating a due date. You know, personally, I would probably simply move it to a due date of even October 14th. That's a full 4 weeks. I don't know that you want to stretch it all the way to the very end. I mean, you can. You can say October 21st. You can,
or
October 28th. Because packets will be posted November 4th. I would almost even say October 31st. Make that your due date for applications. And that's the Monday of the week packets get posted. It gives me plenty of time to have everything, put everything together. And it also gives you all time to look at all of the applications as
well.
Sounds good. Yes. Okay. Would that go out next door?
What's that?
Would that go out next
door? I said,
if
you're going to extend it that long, you better get a big barrel.
Hey, Eric, did you hear both? Asking if this is going to go next door.
Yeah, it'll go on next
door. Yeah, I can put it on next door. Obviously, I, as mentioned, can put it into the newspaper. I will check with the market. So if I'm looking at Nextdoor newspaper, we will put it on our own personal website. And then as far as the physical postings go, which I do believe is what that is referencing in 1780, I will find three, as stated in this exact language, conspicuous places in the district and it'll be posted there for a while. One will be right out front in the marquee board. Ideally, one would be at the market, and then my only other thought, as mentioned, was somewhere out in Lucas Valley Estates.
And also, since the you have the Marin Independent Journal reporter on your distribution list, since we have more time, maybe we don't have to pay for the official legal notice, and she could give us at some point some space in the...
I can ask. I would recommend a legal notice anyway. It's a nominal fee, and then that is a checkbox that, you know, there are people who go through there and read the legal notices. Oh. At least you can't have somebody saying that you didn't properly notice this in that section, mm-hmm. which I've seen that come back. I think it's worth the, I don't think it's more than a couple hundred bucks. But if she would write up a little something about it, it'd be all the better.
All right. Anything else from the board? Linda, did you have a comment about this?
Yes. I'm wondering if you're going to follow your own bylaws as far as the notifications. And in the notification, it does say the local newspaper, it does say the district website, and it does say social media.
Okay.
So you are definitely putting it on the Nextdoor website?
Yes.
Is that correct?
We just did.
And my other question is, you say you plan to post it in three different locations. Why not post it in six different locations?
Do you have suggestions for three more?
You mentioned Lucas Valley Estates. What about the berries and what about the stones? You know, wouldn't it be better to just post it a couple extra times? That way more people would see it. I mean, there's nothing that says you can't post it more than three times, correct?
That is correct.
So, would the board like to post it more than three times somewhere?
I don't see a need for it, given that...
You don't see a need for that?
I can't tell you the last time I noticed a physical posting that was stuck on... I mean, I get that it's for legal purposes, but even my HOA, the way that they notice meetings, I don't get an email. It's a little signboard thing on the median strip in the middle of Miller Creek Road, and they do it quarterly. You know, I mean, it's word of mouth, it's social media, it's doing all these things, but putting up more signs on a...
I'm only saying three more signs.
Sure, I just, if you're going to do three, do 20. I mean, I just don't see the point.
If you're going to do Lucas Valley Estates, why aren't you going to do the berries and the stones?
The point is just to pick three, just to have three, in my opinion. But, I mean, I would leave it up to Eric, because he's, who's ever putting the signs up, but I don't see a need.
Also, in terms of berries, the berries email distribution list, that's layberries.
Mm-hmm. All right, are we ready to move on to the consent calendar?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, item F, draft minutes of regular meeting of August 9th, draft minutes of special meeting August 31st, and bills paid numbers 158 through 282. Do I have a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Second. Any discussion?
I just have a question. On the bills paid, GASB 68 reports, what is that?
That is reports that CalPERS produces. We are it's kind of a, we don't really get the choice of do we want to buy them from them or not. That is the fee. This year it is actually not even as complete of reports as they have done in the past. I actually have a question out to our auditor in terms of all of the information in there being contained that he needs. He is actually researching that for a couple different clients at this point in time. They do not have the same actuarial type of information that they contained last year, which was the first year that they did this. I actually got contacted by an outside company who says, hey, you know, these don't have this information, and we can perform this for you, and here would be the cost. I said, send me everything in an email, please, which he did, which I then forwarded to our auditor and said, do I need something extra like this?
So this is about our retirement accounts?
This is, yes and no. This is actually specific to this year. This is the information that the auditor needs that will go into the audit and be reflected on the balance sheet.
And this is information about... What do the reports tell us, I guess?
Well, I can give you the ones from last year. I mean,
no, just like big, you know, like.
Is it OPEB? Is it pension?
What
is
pension. It? Mm-hmm. It's current current valuation as it's reflected on your balance sheet of liability.
Okay, thank you. And the MIP that Shane submitted for, what is MIP?
Marinwood in the Park.
Music in the Park, okay.
We have to have our own acronyms. It's important.
Bill had something.
Just for the chief, the last pay period.
Overtime?
Yeah, the was that because of the extra, or the lack of people that we had on
board? I had to do, Captain Heine was out for a 2-week period, serving as a safety officer in a couple different fires and backfilling him. Okay. Majority of that will be coming back in reimbursements from Cal Fire.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah. Question for Shane. Why two payments for the slide inspection?
Thank you. We have multiple inspections.
No.
And one's for the
actually,
state.
No, sorry, not to cut you off. We had a pop-up inspection.
Right.
So we had our normal slide inspection, mm-hmm. and then they came back and was like, surprise, we're here
surprise
again.
Surprise shopper.
Yeah.
Like the next day or something?
It was
a week.
It was about a week or two later. Yeah, mm-hmm. where they said surprise.
Get
and then
pay for pop-ups.
They
passed the flying colors.
Wow. But we passed the flying colors.
They showed up on Saturday when we weren't here.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
So yeah, so
anything
unprecedented, it probably.
So they knew that we just passed the inspection
a week before. The second inspection was operations. So we watched whether our guards were in the right
place.
Oh,
I see.
Got it. Okay. Very good.
They are a little short on some funds, so they
evidently
get their revenue.
No particular findings or anything like
no,
that?
No, we passed my hopes.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
And then pool chemicals, still $3,000?
Salt.
Salt.
Okay, anything else from the board?
Please, someone knows what's going on around here.
Any comments from the public?
All
right, can I call the question?
Linda.
I move to.
Just for open time.
I move to approve.
Sorry,
no, we've already done that.
Sorry.
Oh,
yeah, yeah. I'll call the question.
Aye.
In favor? Aye. Great. Public comment open time for items not on the agenda. Linda?
Yes. And I want to start by saying this is open time for the public to speak. Obviously, I'm the only public here. It's not time for the board members to respond and discuss. It's not time for board members to counterpunch the public's words, debate, or to argue with the public, or to have the last say, trying to negate the public's expression. I've been attending board meetings under four different presidents, and this is by far the most oppressive, argumentative, and least democratic of all the boards. There's so much contempt for differing opinions, and I hope this changes. You shut down speech, you no longer allow public correspondence to be included in the agenda packet. One person actually said correspondence is worthless. You've increased censorship and you do not allow the public to be included during the board's discussion of agenda items. You wonder why, this was Mr. Miller, you wonder why Marinwood residents don't attend these meetings. Well, that's part of why. You make up your own rules, you choose to get around the Brown Act laws, you show prejudice against certain audience members who try to add value and different ideas and perspective to the district matters. And I'm amazed that the person sitting at the center chair changes so easily from a really nice person to an oppressor. I have watched other public town meetings that are much more professionally and fairly run. The Marinwood Board many times exhibits disgraceful behavior and at times has become a laughing stock for the county. I can't wear this Marinwood t-shirt anymore to the dog park because people comment about Marinwood and what's in the IJ and what's on social media. I'm very happy that Mr. Kai is stepping down, and I certainly hope that the new board will be a little bit more reasonable. Thank you.
Thank you for that. All right, moving into item H, district matters. Item one, update from ad hoc committee to address district unfunded future liabilities. Jeff, are you starting with this?
I'll take a whack at this.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Soon, too, if I can find it. Okay. So, this past month, we took a little jog to the left of just paying attention strictly to OPEB and pensions, and we started to pay attention. And this is with a certain amount of attention to issues that were brought to us by the public in past meetings. And that is to start paying attention to capital reserves and fixed assets and the district's current condition. So we've begun that process. It is by no means complete. We've had a pretty good give and take with the Park and Rec department. We have yet to actually initiate that with the safety function, but we will be doing that shortly. What's going into that is looking at the capital asset. Number one, looking at capital reserve policy, making sure we're doing something lucid, i.e. we're not buying $45 equipment and calling it a capital asset and depreciating it. We actually have we define a threshold above which we will have fixed assets capitalized. Also, understanding where we are in the life cycle of particularly big ticket assets, vehicles, et cetera, and understanding to the best we can what our forecast will be in terms of replacement and or improvements to those assets. So this is all part of big ticket items that we need to reserve for in addition to these unfunded liabilities that we've been working on. Without doing this homework, we're doing sort of half of what we need to do. So that's one thing. Again, I'm hopeful that by the October meeting, we'll have wrapped that up and have a fairly good idea of not only our fixed assets, our policy, but also as long as 2023, 2024, when Measure A exhausts under its current life cycle, that, you know, we understand what can be funded with Measure A, what we're going to have to put aside ourselves. Okay, so that's one thing. We received the CalPERS actuarial reports, which I think we just spoke about, and I've updated a table with the results from the 2014-15 calendar year, in which CalPERS earned 2.4%. It's somewhat enlightening, and I think it puts in specific relief what happens when CalPERS does not meet its 7.5% projection. So we'll go through that chart in a second. Both Eric and I have reached out to OPEB providers, and we've gotten responses, really detailed responses, from two providers. We have now scheduled in future meetings a presentation by an executive of each of those companies who will come and talk to us, talk to the board, talk to the public about their particular trust programs. So that we can all move forward to making a lucid decision on where we're going to place funds for the future. So more on that later as well. I'll turn your attention to the chart on page 3 of the document, and if you don't mind, I'll take a couple of seconds to sort of explain it, since I've looked at it before and many of you have not. Essentially, the top chart was as of the CalPERS actuarial reports as of June 2014, the bottom chart as of June 2015. There are some differences, obviously. In the top chart, or in the bottom chart, I removed the 2016-17 year under the so-called ARC payments, simply because it didn't change and we've already paid it. So if we look across the rows, or the swim lanes, what we're looking at in the first line of each section is miscellaneous normal percent. This is the percentage of payroll that we pay on an ongoing basis for that particular classification. The UAL is the unfunded liability that pertains to that particular classification of employee. So, for all intents and purposes, as far as ARC, or annual required contribution, we've gone up, and you'll see the numbers down in the bottom column in red, being the changes that have happened year by year due to the fact that CalPERS fell short in their return on investment. So for all intents and purposes, 2021, which we had 356,530 as the annual required contribution as of 2014 actuary, has now jumped up to 430,674, an increase of 74,144. What does that mean? Those are monies that come right out of operations. We have to set that aside. That is not a future thing. That is money that we're going to be paying out of that year's budget. Okay? As opposed to OPEB, which is, we'd love you to pay it, but you don't have to. Okay? On the right-hand side of these charts, questions?
No, I was just saying, for now.
For now.
Yeah, right, right. On the right side of the chart is the unfunded liability balance. This is the actual unfunded liability that we're holding out there that we're trying to, and have in the past, actually decremented. This year, we didn't. It went right back up and, in fact, beyond where it was in 2013. So we had reduced the liability to $2.9 million as of the end of 2014. We had a net decrease in 2014-15 of two employees, and yet due to the fact that we only CalPERS only returned 2.4% as opposed to the 7.5% assumed, our liability went up $650,000. So that paves the way for, I mean, that should get us to think a little bit about the fact that in 2016, their return on investment was 0.6%. That's obviously going to have a significant impact on next year's actuaries. So, again, unfunded liabilities are extremely important for this community, and it's something that we need to pay attention to, and I think the board is focused on doing exactly that. Are there questions? That's it.
Any questions from the public? All right, let's move on to update from ad hoc committee to review, revise, create district policies and procedures. Isabella.
So Eric and I spent a significant amount of time with our best friend employee handbook that is now in, I think, the most, the best shape I've seen it.
Woo-hoo.
So it will be sending it to the council, right, for final blessing, and then to the union.
Yeah.
I swear, I thought we'd been here before, not to interrupt.
I know. But now that I've actually seen it,
oh,
and I've held it,
it's a good document.
And it's, believe me, within the last month, within the last couple of months, it really changed for the better.
It wasn't poking fun at the board.
I know.
Okay. It's been popping around for a while.
Yeah,
so this is good.
It's
good
certainly
movement.
A deja vu, and poke your fun at whatever.
Yes.
I'm sorry, I realized it said on there discuss next project. Apostrophe S.
So we have the conflict of interest resolution to approve. And then, what did I send you? I don't remember anymore.
Record retention policy.
Which is another monster that Eric needs a few moments to digest, because we are not a state institution, therefore certain laws don't apply to us. Mm-hmm. However, there is an expectation that we do have policy in place, and there are actually recommendations out there that we will follow. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of, you know, putting it together, making sure it makes sense for our organization, mm-hmm. because the guidelines are kind of for anything out there, for a water district, for the waste management, whatever.
Okay.
So we're
cool.
Just adjusting and making sure it's, by the time it gets here, maybe next month, maybe in 2 months, but it will make sense. The employee handbook is certainly the priority. Mm. And then I'm also finalizing the the new website, the design-wise, and the kind of from the point of view of stuff that we cannot do in-house, because the rest will be just Paula and I working on adding pages and adding content. So.
All right. Any questions for Isabella around this topic or comments? Okay. Anything from the public? All right. Number three, resolution 2016-06, adopting a conflict of interest code. Do I have a motion?
I move to approve.
Second.
All right. Discussion? Any discussion?
Where would one find the information to find out if they were in compliance or not in compliance?
I don't understand your question.
If I have a conflict of interest, where, how would I find out?
Like, you mean, do you have something that you must disclose in a category? If you look at Appendix B.
No, I mean, I don't fall into any of this.
Right.
Because
right. I just have a house and I just live here. I have no investments anywhere.
Right.
Well, but if you actually...
True or not true, we all had to sign this when we ran.
Well, you correct? Filed a Form 700. What yeah. this is basically has more to do with day-to-day business decisions, so on and so forth. It's a biennial requirement. It must be revisited every 2 years. This document is basically the same document that, to the best of my knowledge, has been approved for the last 8 to 10 years. That was discussed at a board level. They came up with Appendix B. All of the other stuff is boilerplate government language included by reference, which is completely allowable and recommended by law, because it is a mini multi-page thing where I put whatever the Cal Code of Regulations 18730, or whatever that term yeah. is, and I actually purposely included a link to it on this version of it, so that way it could easily be found by members of the public. And that's kind of where this is at. Your Form 700 is slightly different. This is also designating employees of whom this policy applies.
Okay, this particular policy is not only for the board, but for employees of the district.
If they're listed on here, correct. District manager, department heads, any in-house attorneys, as well as consultants.
Okay, and by adopting this, we're covered?
Yes.
Okay.
And do we change the president's name?
I will on the copy that gets signed, yes. This was created.
Can I pretend to be Justin? That would be funny.
If I had his checkbook, I'd love it.
Yeah, it'd be awesome. All right, any other discussion on this? No. Any discussion about it? Okie dokie. Can I call the question? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right. Resolution 2016-07, requesting temporary transfer of funds from Marin County Treasurer.
Sure. This is something we have to do every year as we enter a
dry spell.
I actually believe that we would make it well into the October meeting, but there is no harm in submitting this document early. We do not incur any level of interest charge until we actually start to dip into the red.
And what is it, like less than 1%?
It is a little bit
more.
A little bit more than 1%. It's very nominal, and it also balances out with any interest we gain. This is for funds that we have pooled in the county treasury with county funds. The county is not writing us a check for $1.5 million. We are not borrowing $1.5 million. This just means we can go in the red up to $1.5 million, which is actually much lower than the threshold allowed, because we can do up to 85% of our expected tax revenue, and that includes special assessments, which are not quite, but over three. So this, again, is doing it at this point. It's something that's going to have to be done. If you don't do this meeting, it's going to happen at the October meetings. I don't believe we'll make it to the November meeting with a positive cash balance. And again, you incur no interest except for days in which you have a negative balance.
Cheapest money in town. Is there a motion?
Motion to approve.
I'll second that.
I have a question.
But can we talk about it? Any discussion among the board?
So in essence, we're just getting something that we know that we're going to do later on out of the way now.
Yes. You are exactly right.
We're speeding through it. All right, comments from the public.
Well, I just want to know, do you remember what it was last year?
What was last year? I'm sorry.
This dollar amount in the resolution.
It was the same.
Same. Okay, thank you.
All righty.
And I would say, I don't think we got even close to being in the red $1.5 million.
Mm-hmm. Okay, item 5, district manager report.
Can we need to
vote? Oh, sorry. I'm like excited about speeding.
Let's not vote on it after all.
All right, I'm sorry. I'll call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, district manager report.
Well, again, I try to give you a detailed report so that way I don't need to verbalize too much in this. The accounting system, like I said, kind of the big challenge now has been really trying to unravel the chart of accounts and make something consistent across all boards, and I'm trying to get that done as quickly as I can, because if we do reassign some costs to a different number, that's going to be some journal entries to make, so I'm trying to get that done quickly. Jeff and Bill have actually been kind of helpful in bouncing off, so I've created a spreadsheet that allows me to see everything and all departments as on one piece of paper, which really was kind of the eye-opener to say, okay, we're using different account numbers for we're using the same account numbers for different things depending on department.
So now, for example, you have the same number for, let's say, office supplies, whether they are for...
I'm trying to get there. Right now, we are coding everything to the line account number that is in the approved budget. I have not made any executive decisions and said this is now going to go to there. But I'm getting there. The solar project, as you've seen, as you've been by, I mean, it's going very well. Bandwidth's been good. I just peeked out again tonight. They have almost all of the panels installed now on the
pool
shade structure mm-hmm. in the back. I think it looks really good. Most notably, just in Danwin's credit, and Shane, you're free to chime in. I think they've been very good in monitoring the safety and keeping it as clean and as less impactful as possible, recognizing it's not only a public place, but a public place where everybody walks around barefoot. So they've been very good about that, which I've appreciated. The pension audit, ironically enough, I actually got a phone call today from one of the people on the CalPERS side who we've been working with, and the nuts and bolts of it. That phone call was, I know I owe you a follow-up, and you have followed up multiple times. I don't have an answer for you right now. And I said, okay, well, I've got a deadline quickly coming. And he said, yeah, we can have that extended, especially since a lot of this is due to our own internal delays and not yours. So we've provided them the information they need to date. They need to get back to us on next step. Part of maintenance building.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Do you have a ballpark of the impact of this?
I don't at this point in time. I think it will be fairly minimal from a cost perspective. The one cost thing is going to be backtracking and coming up. And in fact, backtracking is impossible. So it's going to be coming up with something that they deem fair and reasonable for prior uniform purchases made by the district provided to safety employees. However, and Carolyn has done her best to go back and research this, looking at every vendor, invoices don't specifically state these two shirts were purchased for this employee. We are doing that going forward, obviously, because we'll be reporting it at the time purchases are made. But back then, nobody understood, you know, and we're talking 10 years ago, nobody understood that this was even a pensionable item because they weren't getting a uniform allowance. We were simply saying, here's your uniform, wear it. Well, the value and cost of that uniform is pensionable and subject to contributions, both employer and employee. So that'll add it up to some degree, because I personally would have a hard time saying, hey, you know that uniform we bought you 10 years ago? Well, I'm now going to deduct your employee portion of it from your next paycheck. At the end of the day, it's something that we should have been doing back mm-hmm. then. Moving forward, it will be deducted. You know, appropriate employee and employer contributions will be made, and Carolyn will plug everything into CalPERS, and they will be well aware of it. So it's hard for me to give you an exact number. I don't think it'll be huge, but We're talking about contribution amounts.
But there's also been some relaxation in the, thou must go back and prove everything that you've purchased for the last 10 years.
Well, they, that is part of my, the next round of conversation I need to have with this gentleman is...
It is, I
wouldn't even say almost.
It's
impossible for us to go back by employee and say, so what we can do is say, look, according to the terms of our MOU, we purchased things at this much current day cost of these items. I have costed out and the chief has gotten me the information that I need. Here's the cost of everything that's purchased for them annually. Here's the cost of everything that's purchased for them every 3 years. We need to set, you know, and the fact that right now we don't have a record retention policy in place. If we did and we said we hold on to this type of record for 5 years, well, then we could only go back 5 years.
Got it.
Hence the value of having retention policies and such in place.
Is this uniforms and turnouts?
It's not safety gear.
Okay.
Yeah, turnouts, things like that are considered safety gear. This is uniforms. Like for the parks aspect of it, everything we give the park is safety gear. At least that's how I'm looking at it.
So this is exclusive to the fire department?
Yes. They're the only ones we provide uniforms to.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I interrupted you.
That's the big one. Caroline, can you think of any other of the points in there that might have some level of a cost impact with them? There are certain things. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I think it's going to be minimal, honestly.
Honestly, the largest incurred cost is going to be the time it's going to take all of us to put this together, to be honest with you. The other thing that will be coming out of this is we need to have salary schedules that are board approved, which I still will need to create, put on a future agenda, possibly the October one if I get that done in time. For positions that will never, ever, ever by design actually be enrolled in PERS. And I'm talking about here's our part-time camp counselors, here's our part-time this, and I gotta go back and backtrack to a certain period of time and so on and so forth. So it's just, we don't have a published salary schedule for those positions.
I see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and by design they will never be enrolled in PERS. PERS doesn't care.
All right, park maintenance building replacement initiative. Anything else to say about that?
And obviously Jeff's played a large role in this too, as has Shane. Mostly I wanted to get this on here primarily to continue to build public awareness that this is what we're doing. It seems like every time we round a corner on this, we recognize another set of considerations that need to be thought about as we go through this. I actually, through the help of Tom Horn, was able to uncover a large amount of documentation, I say large, more than I knew existed, from the last time this was discussed in 2010. That also included some professionally created site plans, topographic maps of the whole area. That was actually done by I.L. Schwartz and Associates. It was the same gentleman actually who was here last meeting with the
Oaks people,
One of the more highly recognized and respected people in land surveying and civil engineers in the county. He actually came down and met with me on last Friday, kind of walked me through so I understood, as well as gave me his recall from what he remembered from that time. I've also been having conversations as allowable with neighbors immediately in that area on Quietwood, as I put in here. Feedback has primarily been positive thus far. I have heard some concerns. I am making some levels of notes of those, but those are actually very individual concerns to very specific people or their worries, not necessarily larger or macro level concerns. It is coming along. At the end of the day, speaking openly, my fear is even though we have put aside $80,000 out of Measure A this year for this initiative, that may not be enough. As we get into exploring certain other, county and code requirements that come along with this, I am trying my darndest as I can to put together a draft RFP on this, because my next recommendation, I think, is really put this out and let's get some actual bids so we can really kind of wrap our head around various types of proposals and what it may cost us to do this. Just because you put out an RFP process doesn't mean you need to award.
There was also a recommendation to go to county and ask some questions in and around the modular building out there, mm-hmm. and see if we could collect some of the information that they brought up at that time, some of the concerns they brought up at that time. So that's information that we would be able to fold in to this project, or at least be able to anticipate. So you need to keep on pushing on that as well.
Yeah, I haven't had a chance to get down to the county yet
since Friday.
But yeah, basically to pull the permit application as well as all notes from when we did that project, which mm-hmm. I believe was 04?
02.
02?
I think 02, I could be wrong.
But the thought is they'll still have that on file or microfilm at the worst.
Mm-hmm. So what is the condition of the modular unit since it's...
It's in good shape.
Yeah.
14 years now.
You know,
it's in fine shape.
Chime in. I mean,
it's still in decent shape.
Doesn't leak.
Well, I was just wondering about the roof more than this exterior size, because that's the one that gets beat more than anything else.
Yeah, so far so good.
Especially with all the trees around it.
Yeah,
yeah, it's held up. It's got some horseshoe dents in it, but nothing too serious.
Dense, that's all.
All right, any other questions for Eric?
Not
important. Any from the public?
I do. I have three questions. First one is about solar. Do we know anything about who is doing the financing yet? What company?
Well, right now, it's still with C2 Beta Holdings. I mean,
so
we are not financing a solar system.
I understand.
All we're doing is paying, you know, that is an arrangement between other parties, and I'm sure it could very well possibly get sold off throughout the course of the thing. All we're doing is paying for the power that it generates.
So what you're saying is no, you don't know yet.
I haven't asked the question.
When will you be asking the question?
I don't know that I will be.
Don't you think it's a good idea to know who is doing the financing? Since they were looking for financiers and couldn't find any, and then they had to delay the project, and then they said, oh, well, we'll find these interval guys who are really good on the East Coast, and they'll find the financiers. And
so
they're still looking?
I don't think that's what they said, personally, and I think
that
group that financed the project, and I think the fact financing is for construction and build, as well as future maintenance, and I think that construction is happening at this point shows that the project is financed.
Well, I understand that, but...
So what was your next question, Linda?
The question was, who's doing the financing, and your answer is you haven't talked about it yet, you haven't asked.
It's not,
so,
I think what Eric's saying is that it's irrelevant. And unless there's full board support for doing that information.
It's irrelevant. Okay, so my next question is about this district manager's report mentions there is a copy of the project management document for Mr. Naylor was passed out at the Park and Rec meeting, is that correct?
Yes, we went over that.
Mm-hmm. Where can I get a copy of that?
From the Park and Rec agenda.
From the Park and Rec?
Agenda, it was part of the packet.
Oh, it was part of the agenda. Oh, okay, thank you.
I don't think it was the most recent meeting, I think it was two meetings ago.
It was two
I don't
meetings.
Think it was last month's meeting, I think it was the month prior, so where are we in September, August, July?
I would say so.
I think it was in the July packet.
July, okay, thank you. And then the other thing is there a plan yet for what the maintenance shed is going to be looking like? Does anybody know what they need, or?
There is a schematic that was prepared by one of our park staff, Victor. It is essentially a paper drawing. So in a conversation with Irv Schwartz the other day, he mentioned that as this evolves, and as soon as we can, it would probably be time to engage an architect, hopefully one that will do it pro bono, you know, to actually do a physical drawing of what we're anticipating. So that's something that we talked about last week, and we have not engaged anybody at this point.
But there have been interviews with the park staff, because I know you've been working on that.
Mm-hmm.
And so you know basically what you need. You know, you need shelves, and you need this, and doors.
Yes, yes. Orientation of garage doors. I mean, we went down to the point. The staff, by the way, is extremely careful and meticulous about their footprint in that area, noise, light, all that stuff. I mean, we've gone down to, you know, talking about the rollers on garage doors and how we can mitigate noise when they're opened up at 7 o'clock in the morning.
And so, is the cargo shed involved in this as well?
So there's outdoor storage. We anticipate outdoor storage for a couple of vehicles. There will be some sort of storage outside. Okay. Haven't defined exactly what that's going to look like, but that was also included in Victor's.
So you've got things written down.
Yes.
That you know you need.
Yes.
Okay. Uh-huh. Thank you.
The cargo shed was strictly discussed as a option by which to store the things that are currently in there. If the route is that that building needs to be torn down to build a new building, you have items in that building that need to be stored somewhere. That's the only time I recall personally a cargo shed, not a cargo unit being part of the permanent design.
Well, there is an outdoor area, I mean an outdoor shed structure of such that that he did include in that schematic, I believe. I'll go back and check. What else can I say? We also talked about the footprint and and proximity to the creek. We've talked about, what the facility would look like from the road, and of course, strict attention to what it would look like to the neighboring houses. So,
but it's not really on a plan yet. It's just
no, I mean, you know, the plan that was done in 2010 was very, very different than the one we're considering right now. So, there are pros and cons to each of those plans. And, it's still evolving.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, moving on to item I, Fire Department Matters. Draft minutes of the Fire Commission meeting of September 8th.
Well, if nobody's here, but we did have a pretty productive meeting. Everything is covered in that. We will cover it later on in my report. If you have any questions from the Fire Commission meeting, we can answer. Mm-hmm. To Bill, can come, but thanks to Bill and Jeff for showing up.
Yeah. I have this one burning question.
Yes.
What's a landmine attachment?
Landmine or landline?
I thought it said landmine attachment. Yeah.
It's an attachment. It's an attachment that allows the bar to slip in and use it as a yoke, like this. So you have a singular attachment. So you have like you pull it up like this, and it can move either way.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Nice.
Excellent answer.
Okay.
I don't know where you got
that.
It was
off the purchase order.
The purchase order.
Yeah, but you're jumping ahead.
Is that the one you can't read? It's in like
an eye chart.
It's the one that I had to hit.
All right.
Build on my screen to read it.
So, fire chief's report. An activity summary. Any questions?
The one thing I would like to go over that is not brought up in a later agenda item that we did discuss in the fire commission meeting is the sale of the reserve type 1 apparatus, and you can see that the commission did discuss it and do a motion and second on it. The engine has been for sale on various websites for $30,000. I've had a couple of inquiries for donations. I did have one concrete offer of $18,000, paid for over 3 years. We talked a little bit more. The commission recommended the selling of the reserve engine to the Plumas County Department. It's the Longview Volunteer Fire Department in Plumas County, in the amount of $18,000 over 2 years, and that revenue be earmarked towards the purchase of a new utility pickup truck in a future budget. I also support movement in this direction, just as that the engine has been listed for 3 or 4 months now, and this is really only the concrete offer that we have. And also, Longview Valley Fire Department is extremely excited about this option. So, I don't know if we want just head nods, giving the chief and the manager approval to move forward with this.
Well, I think what the commission recommended was basically countering this with 18,000 payable over 2 years.
2 years, right, down to
so,
three.
Right, so at this point, I would say we're still, need to find out if they would even move in that direction.
Okay.
To that aspect, if they were willing to do that and all this, is this something that the board would need to have want agendized as a separate motion?
Yes.
Moving forward to sell this.
So can we direct the chief to investigate whether this is a
absolutely
a reasonable?
Okay.
Yeah.
Happy to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's some stuff in my report. There's a few things on some of the grant stuff I've been working on, and this isn't part of our grant, but it's all agendized, so, or it's all written. If you have any questions on the report, the one thing you do need to move on is the positions in the commission with those for the later agenda items. Any other questions?
Anything being done for Jim Ray?
At this point, no.
Mm-hmm.
I think him having the first Tuesday of the month free is a ward enough, but he's just really busy and couldn't make the meetings anymore.
Yeah.
I think a letter from the board would be nice, recognizing him. And I did tell Jim, who I have a lot of respect for, that there may be issues the fire department needs assistance with or the board needs guidance with, and that I would be reaching out to him to come to meetings to help support those things. And
okay.
He's willing to do that.
Okay. Very good.
So on that note, how about we go to item 3, resignation of James Ray from Fire Commission, effective immediately. Do I have a motion to accept the resignation?
I move to accept.
Second.
Any discussion?
No.
Okay, hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, item 4, letter from Irving Schwartz, alternate fire commissioner, requesting appointment to become regular fire commissioner. Do I have a motion?
I move. Second.
Any discussion?
No, I think Irv is great. Always comes up with a lot of great comments and questions.
He has very direct questions
yeah.
that ask good things,
yeah.
and it's I appreciate him being involved.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Broad experience and good person.
Okay.
Great power.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Can I, just for Jim, just so I have a game plan, can Eric and I, with maybe some assistance from Jeff, who's been involved with the Fire Commission the longest, come up with a letter addressed to him with signatures from you guys and the other fire commissioners, and we'll just present that to him at the next board meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Copy. Eric, Tom, Jeff.
Sure.
We've done this before. We should be able to pull it off.
All right, is there any comment from the public? I know I breezed through the last couple pretty quickly. Item 5, agreement between the County of Marin and Marinwood Community Services District for fire protection and emergency services to CSA 13.
Sure, I'll jump in on this. This is our annual agreement that we form strictly for CSA 13. It's really a fairly complex agreement in that there's multiple factors at play, starting with the percentage of CSA 13 to the whole of the combined district, as well as true-ups from prior year estimates versus actuals, as well as their percentage of allocated reimbursements. I have sat down, I've gone over the numbers with Ron Marinoff, who is the CSA 13 rep, not only to the Fire Commission, but in many ways actually to the County of Marin. After I've done that, I've gone through everything with the person I work with in the County Administrative Office. Everybody has signed off on what these numbers are and how they were arrived at, and I would also expect Board of Supervisors approval based on that.
Alrighty, any questions from the board?
Although Ron did say if we sell the engine for $18,000, he wants 26% of it credited back.
Sorry, it's only 25.92 now.
Oh, is it? That's over change rate. Perfect.
It's around 5.92.
Correct.
Alright, any other comments from the board? Comments or questions?
As long as it's okay with Ron,
I know, where is he tonight? He's usually here for the big ones like this.
He could not make it tonight. I actually spoke with him yesterday, and he and I literally met for an hour, and I pulled all of the data out so he could really look at it, showed him all the actuals. I mean, these are unaudited, and he understands that. But
it's one proof.
I think it is. I'm very comfortable with the soft close on it, okay, as far as actuals go. So,
right.
And if Ron thumbs it up, that goes a long way with the CAO office, because if he didn't, they know they would have to hear from him too, because much like my office, oftentimes they turn around and he's standing there. So.
All right. Do I have a motion on item 5?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion from the board? Any discussion from the public? All righty, call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Now we get to the agreement between the County of Marin and Marinwood CSD for fire protection and emergency services from the juvenile hall site.
This is very similar and actually based on a lot of the same factors, and actually does incorporate to a degree the CSA 13 contract, which is why they kind of go hand in hand. This has also been vetted, not necessarily by Ron, because this has nothing to do with what comes out of their taxpayer dollars, but has been vetted through the County Administrative Office, and they are in agreement that this seems appropriate as well.
All right. Can I get a motion from the board?
So moved.
Second.
All right, any discussion from the board or questions? Anything from the public? Can I call a question?
Aye.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. Date of next Fire Commission meeting, October 4th.
Correct.
Okay, moving on to Park and Recreation Matters. Item 1, draft minutes of Park and Rec Commission meeting of August 23rd. Any questions or comments?
No.
I just saw one typo in the bottom of the page, preliminary discussion, potential conversation of portions. I think it meant conversion.
Conversation, oh, instead of conversion.
Yeah.
Right.
Made it for entertaining reading.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else on the minutes? Mm-hmm. Okay, moving on to recreation and park maintenance activity reports.
Yes, so we've launched our after-school program. It's been running extremely well. I feel like we've kind of got everything down at this point. The person running it, Angela, from the summer camp program, she's doing a great job. I've been getting rave reviews from parents, at least I have, so we're super happy with that. And we lost one kid. The pool's now operating on the fall schedule. As I stated, we still have a lot going on. Lifeguard training, swim lessons. We're booked up fully on weekends for parties, etc. Fall special events. We have the ever-popular Marinwood Fall Brew Fest coming up Saturday, October 1st. Then the following week, we have the Marinwood Art and Wine Show on the 8th, and then the Halloween Harvest Festival on the 14th, so we're keeping staff busy. And then a non-Marinwood recommend, but Alliance Club event is this Saturday, the car show, which they're extremely happy and excited for, so definitely stop by this weekend and check that out on Saturday.
Can I add to that really quickly?
Yeah.
On behalf of Cameron, it wasn't necessarily covered in the chief's report, but they're going to do a little bit of a ceremony at 12:30, kind of ceremoniously handing over the keys to the CERT trailer that they purchased that was actually donated from them and put into the district's name. They're hoping for a little bit of a photo op. Initially, Justin told them that he could go down there, but seeing as how as of 12:01, he's not even on the board anymore. If there's a board member that is free at 12:30, I will be there. The chief will be there. But if there's a board member who would like to come down, keep in mind that as far as the photo op goes, we have reached out to the paper. I don't know if they got any feedback, but they'll probably then submit a picture to the paper. So whatever you have on might very well be a picture in the paper. Ooh. So dress accordingly, I suppose, is my comment. But if any board member would like to come down, or multiple board members, I am sure that Cameron, as well as the rest of the Lions Club, would greatly appreciate it. This Saturday, 12:30, right by the tennis courts.
I may be able to come.
Right.
We're going to have like 60 cars, they said.
Super fired up.
We Ruin the lawn.
Camper is fired up.
Fired up. Granted, this whole thing's got to take place while he's in Hawaii. Hey, I'm in Hawaii. Can you take care of this? Okay.
Will he be there on Saturday?
He comes back tomorrow on Thursday night.
Okay. Well, this puts the whole search trailer thing to bed. And, all right.
So while you're having that, just make sure nobody pounds on the outside of it. It'll sound like an empty drum, right?
Yeah, exactly. We're not going to open it up for them. But there'll be some nice decals.
Yeah.
Anything on the park maintenance activities?
Yeah, so the parks department is still busy at work doing fall duties. We're aerating the fields right now. We'll be closing down portions of the field starting next week for overseeding and skipping the break for about 2 to 3 weeks as we fill in the barren spots. But there'll be something available for everyone at all times.
How has the land design been going?
Better, much better. Yeah. Our communication with them has been good. And in fact, our lawnmower needed some repairs a few weeks ago. And we called them and they're able to switch because they don't normally mow for us, and they were able to bring a lawnmower and mow the fields for us. And so they didn't charge us any change orders or anything like that stuff that I've seen. So they've been good, the new crew. Park maintenance, they've been doing a lot of work in the building. And now we're moving on to the turf, playground repairs, and then we'll be getting ready for all of our winter inspections coming soon. We'll be walking the length of Miller Creek, and I'm sure finding many trees that need to be cut and removed clear out of the way. In addition, we'll be going through all the equipment and making sure everything's ready to go for the upcoming winter. So things have been busy.
Okay, any questions for Shane? Okay, thank you, Shane.
This hardwood floor recoat. Mm-hmm. Didn't we just have the hardwood floors replaced?
They were replaced about 4 years ago. The floors get recoated, screened and recoated annually.
Annually, eh? Yeah. Those kids.
It's a beaming.
Honestly.
Rentals and classes probably put a much larger beating on it than the kids do. The events that we rent out and things like that, especially any fancy events, people coming in with their fancy shoes or heels or whatever, puts a lot more damage on there than kids running around with their tennis shoes. I'm just trying to not blame it on the kids.
Yeah. I'm just kidding.
Okay, so the next Park and Recreation Commission meeting is September 27th. New and other business, item K, and item 1, election of board vice president to fill role vacated by current vice president. Does anybody have a motion to nominate one of our fellow board members?
I would like to nominate Bill Shea to become the vice president.
Oh, God.
I knew you would be ecstatic.
You're so nice.
Do I have a second?
Yes, okay. I will second that.
Any discussion? Any comments or discussion from the public?
You gotta let it run just one. Just one. Before I die, I wanna see that.
Okay, hearing none, I will call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'll abstain.
Alrighty. Item 2, district manager objectives and performance evaluation, approve evaluation template, and discuss board involvement process. Who wants to take a stab at this?
Well, I guess I'll take a stab at it. Right. So, essentially, this is building off of the objectives document that we went through last meeting, I believe. And during the discussion of that, it was brought up, gee whiz, well, you know, after you set objectives, there has to be some way of evaluating people under those objectives. So, this is essentially an attempt to define rankings, spread them across the five, in this particular instance, board members who would be rating the district manager and creating an average. There have been some changes, I think Isabella brought up, that have been included in the objectives themselves, and also one of the sections on the original objectives document that's been sort of shoved around into other sections and then eliminated. Mm-hmm. So that's it, pretty much. I think the intention would be, and again, I'm not too sure that this is not uncharted water here, but for us to, and I believe this is within the letter of the law, that we can actually, as a board, conduct this interview in a closed session. And basically, objectively rank the district manager on these performance objectives, perhaps go back and put our comments down, forward them to the president, and the president can make a decision as to whether they would like to do that, do the summarization themselves, or hand that to somebody, and then deliver the review to the district manager. That's pretty much it.
So is the idea to conduct the evaluation before the end of calendar year?
You know, honestly, I know that this sounds a little bureaucratic, and I apologize for my corporate background, but I think it's really, particularly for a position like the district manager's position that, you know, is so involved in just about every aspect of the district, I think it makes sense to do it at least twice a year. Just to have an informal, hey, are we on the same page? Are we going in the same direction? And this and that, just to make sure that we don't let too much time go by where something might have vectored off completely differently. And again, I think the idea of these are as this board refreshes policy and refresh it and hopefully create strategy, that we're having a dialogue with the district manager about those things, not to sit there and, you know, penalize him or anything like that, but, you know, just to make sure that we're pulling in the same direction.
What's going to be to tell me positive things? You have to go to the negative side.
There, well, that's, you know.
So in terms of timeline, what's our plan? Would we be submitting our comments before the end of the year, and then Leah would, I'm sorry, the president of the board at that point, I guess, would be having a conversation with Eric? Would that be the plan?
Again, we can do this, I believe, in a closed session.
Okay.
So we can do it as a body, mm-hmm. or we could have it delivered by an individual or two individuals. Mm-hmm. But from my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, if we had it, if one or two individuals delivered this, we would not have to hold a closed session. Would we?
You wouldn't have to notice the meeting.
Yeah, notice the meeting, I guess, is
correct.
Right. Yeah, so.
But if in essence we set up a time where, say, all of you and I sit down and go through this, you need to notice it under the Brown Act as a closed session under Government
right.
Code Section 54957B1.
Yep. So.
Of course.
You know, since we're on a fiscal year, and things are relatively crazy right at the end of the fiscal year, perhaps a month after the calendar year ends and a month after the fiscal year ends would be a suggestion.
January and July?
Something like that.
August 1st, February 1st?
Yeah, something like
January
that.
31st.
Yeah.
I can work with whatever.
Yeah. No, it would be good to have a more specific. I love this, by the mm-hmm. way. This is really good. We needed a job description for the district manager. We needed the objectives, and now we have the ranking or grading mm-hmm. structure. So that gives us all the tools. Now we just have to implement it and have it. Happen regularly, mm-hmm. so we can have this conversation.
I'm totally sorry. Since this is an approval item, I should call for or ask for a motion first before we're talking. Sorry.
Oh, sorry.
Can I have a motion, please?
We already talked.
I know. We'll talk some more. I'm not. I'm not shutting down the talking.
Okay.
I just like a motion.
Motion to approve.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. Continue discussion. Sorry.
That's too funny. Anyway.
Let's make the dates. Set them in stone, you know.
February and August.
Feb 1, August 1.
Sure.
Is the fiscal year close July 31st or June 30th?
June 30th.
Oh, okay.
June 30th.
Okay, good. Okay, any other comments, discussion from the board? Any comments from the public? Let's call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, moving on to district staff performance reviews. Confirm staffing positions to receive reviews and annual timing of reviews. It's our last page.
Thank you very much, Eric.
Sure.
It was me who asked for it, and that's fabulous. And we can just add yourself and the board reviewing, and we'll have a set calendar. So then we don't have to reinvent the wheel. We just know every December, boom, 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 this happens every whenever you evaluate your guys. Thank you.
Sure.
Can I have a motion?
I move.
It was a tie.
Okay, tie. Who wants a second?
I'll take the second.
Okay, first, second. Discussion? Comments? Any comments from the public? Okay, let's call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Are we really at item L? This is very exciting, you guys. Recognitions?
No.
Oh, sorry. Oh my gosh. K4, request for future meeting agenda items.
Oh, hold on.
You have something, don't you?
Yeah, I just have to get to it.
Were we going to put on the agenda for the purchase of?
Sale of the end reserve engine?
Yeah.
Okay. You don't have to have an agenda item for the purchase of the
exercise equipment.
Exercise in the computer.
No, because it's in the budget.
It's in the budget. Okay. It didn't make the agenda. I was going to talk to Eric about that offline. I think
it's budget that is approved.
Yeah.
I know it was brought up at the commission meeting. So.
Okay. I've got something here. Future agenda items. I don't know if we've really talked about this, or I was just spacing out, but I'd like to have a discussion at some point about where we stand versus the grand jury's opinion on our website and what we're doing with it.
Can we hold off until...
No, I need it right now.
I would love to finish working on the website before we can...
Is it fair to ask how we're doing?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. No. We should have all the items checked off.
Okay.
Once we complete it, because it was mainly about availability of documents on the website and information. So there will be a whole sort of tab added in addition to the fire department, mm-hmm. the recreation department, the park and open space, the district information will be a separate tab, and there will be a...
Okay, I don't think we can talk about it now. I just wanted to know if we needed to put that on an agenda so we can talk about it.
Yeah, you can definitely put it on an agenda to talk about it. I would, probably wait until it's a little bit farther along, and we can bring in a projector and kind of walk you through the highlights of the beta version.
Okay, that's fine.
In terms of the grand jury, it's not my understanding that there is a requirement for any further follow-up.
We're not jeopardizing any dates or...
No.
No, okay. I'm happy to follow up with the foreman of it, but I do... It was merely a suggestion to re-go through their report card and submit. I don't think that would even be published if we did submit. When I say published, I mean on the grand jury website where they publish responses from people requested to respond.
And we can submit the response.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, yeah, right, I remember that.
Yeah, I don't think there's a requirement of follow-up submission proving that, hey, look at these other changes we've made.
And I took their criteria as guide as to what we need to improve.
Understood.
So once we have it finalized, I'll just make sure and double-check that we have all the C's, all the I's dotted, and what do we cross?
T's.
Okay.
Try.
All right.
Seems so mean.
Is it time to revisit the idea of video recording these meetings?
Yes.
By the district.
I'm glad you added that.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay.
It's actually because we've been playing with the idea of posting audio online, but I would much rather we invest in a video.
Yeah.
Would that be in the current budget?
Right, we'll have to probably budget this expense.
I would probably go out and get a few loose bids, not only for the expense, but for the installation.
So, next month agenda item, or just direct you to start getting some bids, or what?
Well, you don't need to direct me, I can start calling around to people who do that, sells and installation on it, and I can certainly put it on the next agenda for an update.
Okay, that sounds good.
How about that?
Thank you.
Any other requests for future meeting agenda items?
I have one that I'm gonna go ahead and gonna say. Linda brought up a good point, and I think you probably need to look at the potential of a future board bylaws amendment. As the board bylaws are currently written, and I meant to bring this up in the earlier section, in regards to the appointment process, it actually states that I will post a notice within 3 days of being informed of the vacancy. You know, hindsight is 20/20. If I were to do that, you would have had no opportunity whatsoever as a board to discuss it. Or anything else, so I would look at changing the language of that, ultimately just stating that it complies with the relevant government code.
Correct.
So I'm happy to draft something like that on a future agenda.
Good idea.
Good. On the bylaw for that period of time, would it be taken as when you hear about it or when it is a resignation at date?
Well, I don't want to get too far into discussion because right now all I'm going to do is draft something up and put it on there. And again, I would just kind of stay within government code 1780 because it very clearly prescribes what steps need to happen.
Yeah.
Okay, anything from the public on future meeting agenda items?
Thank you.
Item L, recognitions and board member items of interest.
Well, I guess we'd have to recognize the outgoing president of the board.
Where is he?
No show.
I know he was intending on being here. I think I'm imagining he got bogged down with packing and getting ready to go, but...
He literally called me minutes before we went into closed session to apologize and state that he had all intentions to come. They have moving trucks showing up in the morning. And they're simply not ready for that, and he couldn't break away. They needed to get more done. And with that, well, that's kind of all we really talked about. Understood. I got to go to a meeting.
I'm sorry to interrupt,
could we write a letter of thank you?
Yeah, I think it would be, I think that would be nice.
As a acting president?
Sure. If Eric wants to draft something, we can all sign it.
Okay, great.
That was smooth.
Does it have to be public? Because that'll change what I draft.
No. I don't think...
Of course not.
Any other recognitions?
So for the first time since I've lived in this community, I actually went to one of the Music in the Park events and found it to be quite an event, quite a joy. I enjoyed it, and it's very clear that a lot of people did. I don't know if we have done this already, but I think we should thank Mr. Hansel for his efforts in supplying the bands again.
Yeah, sure. I promise you at some point I'm actually going to put together a newsletter again. I know.
Oh, that was great when that was before. When was that?
May, April.
So we were going to aim for quarterly with that, right?
Too long ago.
That's okay.
I'm gonna open up this can of worms right now because it's
it's a great thing to pick up.
But I would definitely want to include recognition of Bill and his efforts in putting the bands together and helping out with that particular event as well.
Very good.
And I want to thank the board, actually, all of you guys for being here. I know this can be kind of a thankless job and sometimes very long Tuesday evenings. So thank you all for being here and your input and ideas and thoughts, and yeah.
Very good.
Keep coming back.
Where else would I see Twinkies?
All right. Anything else?
No.
Motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Comments? No.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well run.
So I think I need to
Thank you.